So this project which we've been doing in we began in Pune. It's called the One Home One Toilet project, and we began in the city of Pune, where it has been like a replication because we did it in several wards. The idea was you build 1500 toilets in the city of Pune, for which there was assured funding, and the beginning processes were laid out. So we first began with the entire data collection of the slums across the city, and the slum list was first verified and approved by the corporation, by the municipal urban local body, such that we got a confirmed list of those slums which won't get rehabilitated in the near future. So you know that these are slums which are going to remain in the city. A little background on shelters, that we have been, our focus is working with the urban poor and with the slums. So in that context, so we first got this list approved, and after that then the first step of this project was to get the entire data in terms of the structural maps of those slums and infrastructure mapping. That was done, and it was done with the help of GeoMedia. So it was brought on a GeoMedia platform, on the Google platform. So we had all the data, and which particularly looked at services of drainage, water facilities, availability of community toilets in that community. So we did an entire listing of 317 slums, and the rapid surveys were done. So now we have in the initial phase itself invested in a in developing a data management system, so an MIS, and also defined a particular methodology for doing these rapid surveys, which can now be used in cities to follow. So this was all part of this project, and then we had to build as part of the pilot 1500 toilets in the city of Pune, covering different wards. So there are 15 administrative wards, and the idea was build 100 toilet in each ward, so that you show it to the government, and then it can be replicated by the government. So that has been this project. Now, I was asked to focus on the challenges, so I'll just move on to the challenges. One major challenge is to get funding for these kind of costs, like the data collection, setting up of MIS systems, maintaining a web platform, because all that costs. So technology costs of these kind, it is a challenge to get funding for it, and ongoing support for the same, because there is also a recurring cost to it. Secondly, advocacy with governments. It is a challenge. You have to see which governments are proactive, where we cannot define a plan that you'll get support from X municipal corporation. You have to keep trying and then looking at different options possible, select the best city. So working with government, and also amongst the stakeholders I've mentioned, working with the elected representatives. Because when once you go, you select a slum, then you have to also work actively with the councillor, the elected representative in that pocket, explain the project to them, and take their buy-in before you start working with the communities. It's important, because finally the people of the communities also respect and value their opinion. So that also is a challenge. You have to work quite actively with the elected representatives. In the community engagement part, What I've written is the behavioral change aspect is quite important. See, once you start working with the communities, our project is such where we have community contribution. So how the costing is worked out, I'll just explain that to you in brief. Once the slum is identified, identified that okay, in this slum we will be making 100 toilets and you get funding for it, the cost for building of the toilet, the 70% cost is raised through funding, but 30% is put in by the community member, by the family person, and this they contribute in terms of the labor cost and also a cash contribution, and this has worked quite effectively. We feel that that helps in the ownership also, ownership over the toilet, and it's valued. Getting people to contribute, you have to create the awareness about the issue, about better sanitary conditions, linking the data to the actual value, like telling them that the information is showing that you spend a lot on your health costs and things like that, and this can get reduced if one were to build a toilet in the home. So promoting an awareness, and for that one has to work out the methodology in terms of the workshops you do, the focus group discussions. So basically first we go with the focus group discussions to understand the situation of the community. Then based on those background information, we develop our programs. But there is a kind of a framework which is readily available. So behavioral change is something which is a challenge. When it comes to monitoring usage of the toilets, see, it's easy to monitor that 100 toilets were supposed to be built and 100 have been built. But it's more, the challenge is to monitor the usage of the toilets and usage by all in the family. That's another area which we have been noticing, because very often the younger kids start using it, and families also see the benefit and they say, "Ha, the children have started using it." But there are cultural issues also, why women don't use it. There is some bit of embarrassment associated. They have not been used to going or using the toilet with all the people around in the family. So trying to avoid when others in the family are around using the toilet. I mean, there are different reasons, but monitoring the usage is a challenge. We do it in different ways. There are surveys, there are also pre and post kind of surveys done, focus group discussions, and periodic research also needs to be done. Like you've given the toilet, say in January, you do the research 6 months later just to see whether it is well in use and what's the status. So this is in brief.
Most relevant to almost everyone here. Working with the government and working with elected representatives. I don't know if you are saying differently, but maybe we could just focus on one and take about 4 or 5 solutions discussion around that.
I have tried to address in the past, but you're saying that there are some mechanisms that as an organization you've figured out, but they don't work all the time. So it's not very foolproof yet. But the other thing that I was particularly interested to know more about was that whole mapping perspective that you bring in. Because from my understanding, it gets some participation because you're doing some sort of resource mapping in the community. So you get some participation in, plus you're giving some incentive to the government itself because you're giving back that data and you're, you know, bringing that transparency in. And that is a process that I believe you follow in all your programs in the organization. So I was wondering if, you know, we can learn a bit more about that and how you've managed to figure that out to a certain extent.
So this has been the starting point where all the information is mapped, and we've seen that bringing it on the GeoMedia platform data otherwise just looks like these numbers, but this brings a pictorial representation which is very easy to even explain in communities. It works quite effectively, and they're able to see their houses and spot them. So even if maps are then printed out and taken back to the communities, you can show it to them that, okay, this is where your house is and the community toilet is this far. So typically the images capture the open defecation site, and we are able to see that the community, if you see a maybe I can show you an image. There are many communities where very clearly on the pictorial part you can see that the community toilet is at one end of the community and there's no other option in the other end. So automatically what happens is people on this part residing here, there is an open defecation spot which gets created there. And this showing it to the government as well as showing it to the community helps. So it gets participation from the communities, like you said, and secondly, bringing it to the notice of the government, because we've seen that government very often doesn't have data which is well placed, or they don't use it also very effectively. Very often, they don't have collated data altogether in one place. So sharing this kind of information that there is 85% of a drainage network available in the slum, then rather than spending year after year on community toilet maintenance where there's no sense of ownership, why not invest in individual toilets, which will be a one-time cost, and later then you don't have to spend anything. So that kind of thing has helped. Sometimes you have to just explain the program very well to them. They often are not convinced completely about the community contribution part. So that is one thing. It differs from community to community, but in communities where there is no drainage line, we take the support of the elected representatives, because laying of the drainage and all is not something which the organization can invest in. So there we push the government to lay those drainage lines, and there you have to work with administration as well as political elected representatives, because they have the budgets available. So once you convince them that, okay, there is a need in this community, then if an additional line can be laid out, or the existing line sometimes needs to be made bigger, yeah, changed or replaced, cleaned. There are different kinds of things. So if they are taken on board, then they are willing to work with us, with the administration, that way.
Toilets by women is a challenge. Actually, we have been working on some program with GIZ on urban sanitation plans. And actually, what needs to happen is, normally it is the men, it is participative, your program is definitely, but who participates? Is it men, or it's both men and women, or it's women? Because the toilets mainly are to be useful or to be used by women, because women are the most this thing with affected with open defecation. They cannot go out during day, they have to wait, they have to go early morning or late evening, all those things. That's why we need. So women's participation in the building of the toilet is very important. Where to be built? In the area that they have. If it is in the front, because for the this thing, panchayat or anything, to be convenient to link it to the drainage line and all that, they normally build wherever it is, and women cannot use it. As you rightly said, women can't use it because there are people around in front of the this thing, there will be men sitting there, they can't go to the toilet. So where it should be built so that women can go is another very important thing that to be taken care of by you.
But see, in the urban scenario, the spaces are very small. It is a one-room house very often. So within that, there's a kitchen, there's the space, and often there's a bathroom which itself gets converted into a toilet. So very often that kind of options are also suggested by us, that you could make that into a toilet and keep a plank on it and use it also as a bathroom. So in very tiny spaces, because 10 square foot is the total area of house, when it's less than 10 square foot, people don't go in also for a toilet. So those also have been constraints. And you're right that women do feel the need for building the toilets and they use it. But I was saying, like, in some communities we have seen that maybe the older women or some of the women in the families have not been using the toilet. It has been due to different reasons. We haven't done a very systematic survey or study about that. But there is one impact assessment study which is happening now at the end of 2 years. But we are hoping to get some more concrete data with that.
You said that you have to work closely with the government for them to implement it. So how do you ensure, how do you first, what are the ways that you make this happen? How do you partner with them and convince them to do that? And after that, how do you make sure that they follow up and ensure that those services are maintained throughout?
Mm-hmm. It's an ongoing kind of work. So what we do is, in the first instance, we have a partnership with the at the commissioner level. So in, when you go into a city, you draw up a kind of an MOU. Though they are not paying us in any way, we have an MOU where there is this understanding that when it comes to infrastructure designing or repairing, that will be their responsibility. And shelter will assist in terms of the community engagement and building of the toilets. So that's one thing. And then once that MOU is drawn up, then you are working based on that. So then even at the administrative ward levels, the support is generated. And then I think whoever has worked with governments, you have to keep pushing them at all levels. So if the ward doesn't respond, then you have to go all the way up to the commissioner. And this has been my experience. Within the MOU, we also have one more thing which is put right at the beginning, where we say that the commissioner will also take regular review meetings. So that also helps, where their own staff are brought together on one table. And then challenges which are faced by us, we discuss it with them, and it helps in resolving them across the table.
Housing and sanitation.